is one of their mobile kitchens that they actually...
is that even some, what I call habitual...
beautiful Stop and Shop in the Wilton... penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that it... absolutely. What's the name of the show?
Here's Dan Carter.
Good evening and welcome once again to the Marty Heiser Show. We have a very exciting show this evening. It's of course the anniversary of 9/11. I will have something to share about that. But in the news this week, as you can tell by the newspapers, the issue came to light of domestic violence. Now this is a crime really that happens in the shadows in varying degrees, but there was this time when domestic abuse took place. It was live and recorded on videotape. It happened to be with a famous NFL football player, but my understanding is that this type of domestic abuse happens throughout the country, throughout the world, really, and it's an issue that only has come to light recently in everyone's consciousness because a famous football player was involved and it was covered on videotape and it just spread like wildfire. So I have asked Ann Rodwell-Lawton, was kind enough, she is the program manager for education and outreach of the Women's Center in Danbury, which by the way, if this is something that you're experiencing, domestic violence, and we'll go into details about it, how it can be physical, emotional, economic, sexual, or just verbal domestic violence. If this is something that you're dealing with or struggling with or you know someone, the Women's Center in Danbury has a hotline. That hotline is 203-731-5206. That number again, 203-731-5206. And it's somewhere where you can go, you can call, it's anonymous, and at least have someone with an understanding ear that will know what's going on, what resources are available. You may think, hey, it's just something that happens in our family, but you don't have to suffer in silence. There are resources available. So I'm delighted to be joined not only by Ann Rodwell, the program manager for education and outreach, but also State Senator Toni Boucher, who has done a lot of work on these two issues. Ann, thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having
me. And State
me.
Senator, as always,
pleasure
thank
to be
you
with
so
you,
much.
Marty.
And can you just briefly talk about, because you know it was interesting, and I mentioned this, and believe me, I'll be quiet in a second, but I was preparing for this show, and I had this newspaper, and I was at Dimitri's restaurant in Ridgefield, great restaurant, and the waitress came by and said, just, you know, volunteered, chatty waitress, that girl is crazy, why is she staying with that man? That would be my first question. Why do women stay? And give us a little bit of a background of what we're talking about here.
So it's easy to look at a domestic violence relationship and ask, why is she staying? And it's a very complex issue, and mm-hmm. there are many different reasons. The first reason that I would say victims stay with their abusers is because they love them. At mm-hmm. one point, they were in a healthy relationship. She married him. Sometimes we have kids with our abuser. Mm-hmm. And so it's not just leave him. It's not an easy fix to leave. Mm. There are lots of complex factors. So victims want the abuse to end, but they don't want the relationship to end.
You know, I mean, and I don't mean to focus everything on Ray Rice, NFL mm-hmm. football player, and their situation. It's a little, you see it through the you know, video footage, which I'm sure everyone has seen, and the time frame, but my understanding is she was struck in that violent way, which we've all seen on the video, in February of this year as a fiance. Mm-hmm. Even after that, she goes on to marry this guy, and now they're together and she's his biggest defender.
Mm-hmm.
Explain that to me.
So I don't know personally why she is staying with him.
Yeah.
But I could speculate that she has hope that things will get better.
Uh-huh.
She might fear what will happen when she leaves.
Exactly.
Will she be able to support herself?
Mm-hmm.
Will she find anyone else to love her?
Mm-hmm.
And she loves him and might want to be with him, and she wants the abuse to end, not the relationship. And it's really hard looking from the outside to try and understand it, but there's a lot of complex dynamics going on, possibly manipulation and control.
Mm-hmm.
And we can't just tell victims to leave, because it's not as easy as that.
Mm-hmm.
And victims know what the best choice is for themselves. We don't know what the best choice is.
Is there a spectrum where, I mean, in any ideal relationship, like my lovely wife, she's from Canada. They're mm-hmm. pretty rough up in Canada, actually. And from time to time, if I've misbehaved, she will lash out. And I think I deserve it. But is there a point where the natural give and take within a relationship, and sometimes it's not, you know, the best, if there was a video camera unfolding, when does that cross over into abuse, where someone really needs to reach out to, for example, the Women's Center in Danbury? Is there a spectrum, or how do you judge that?
Well, obviously all couples have fights.
Yes.
And you're right, there is a line when it goes from a fight to abuse.
Uh-huh.
Now, domestic violence involves patterns of abuse or coercive behavior. So there has to be a pattern in place happening. So it's not a one-time event.
Uh-huh.
Often it starts with verbal abuse, emotional abuse, manipulation, possessiveness, and then will escalate to sexual abuse or physical abuse.
Hmm. Interesting. State Senator Toni Boucher, you've dealt with this issue. What
absolutely, are you and mm-hmm. we have been legislatively trying to address it from the earliest of ages, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
When you have cyberbullying with young kids
mm.
on the internet, and then teen dating violence as they get older, and then, as you said, at a very young and impressionable time. But usually there is a pattern, as just was stated, because
mm-hmm.
kids will be mean to each other and a natural pattern and a one-time incident could occur.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's happening continuously and it escalates as they get older, you will certainly, it could lead into domestic violence when they get into relationships as adults.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you were just mentioning, why would someone on the front page of the
mm-hmm.
paper stay? Well, you've got a couple of factors going on here. Oftentimes, and I'm sure you found that as well, individuals that tolerate this oftentimes come from situations at home
mm-hmm.
where that same pattern was existing. So for them, it's not as unusual or as outrageous as we might find it.
Mm-hmm.
The other is also
Daddy used to slap mommy around.
Exactly.
I expect this
exactly.
same thing. And in a weird sort of Stockholm syndrome kind of way.
As being a hostage in a way.
It's affirming.
That's yeah. right. And the issues of things like the fear of losing that support system. In this case, you're talking about an amazing lifestyle, an NFL lifestyle
yeah,
that
yeah.
brings with it all of these advantages that they wouldn't have otherwise, and the sense of loss of that. Can I survive on my own as a woman?
Mm.
Can I economically survive? Am I going to be on the street? That's a huge incentive to stay and tolerate quite a bit of abuse. And this is why it's very important for us to reach the issue early enough so that young students can see that this is not normal behavior, that in fact that it has to be stopped at an early age so that later on they can engage in a healthy relationship and be able to treat each other in a respectful manner. And I might add that there is abuse on the part of men being in an abusive relationship too.
Mm-hmm.
It's very underreported, because imagine a man's pride to say that somehow he's been, you know, abused by either a woman
mm-hmm.
or a wife or even another male. But that's a situation that has to be dealt with, and I'm sure you've encountered that as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the statistics are something in the line of 85% are male, you know, abusing of female.
Right.
But 15% are actually, you know, males
exactly.
that are living in.
But I would say that number is not realistic, because I would say it's very underreported, simply
yeah.
because of the pride issue, the male issue, that they it would take an awful lot for someone to ever come forward and say, you know, I'm in an abusive relationship. My wife, either verbally, financially, or physically, could abuse.
You know, it's interesting. We do this show live, you know, once a week, and a lot of times we'll pick up on the issues that of the day. And a few weeks back, tragically, Robin Williams took his life. And so we did a show on suicide, suicide prevention, and it's in a similar way, the same kind of a spectrum. You know, where does just, I feel down, I feel blue, I'm not happy, where does that cross the line into this person needs outside help, he's having suicidal thoughts? And it was interesting for them. If they talk about suicide, if someone is looking on websites, you know, how would someone, you know, commit suicide? If they're speaking with others, that those are key indicators that this has crossed the line. It's not just I feel blue, I'm a little depressed, but it's going over into suicidal thoughts. My question to you is, in a relationship, and again, you said every relationship has its ups and downs, what are some of the red flags, the indicators that would say, you know, this isn't just normal give and take in a marriage, but or a relationship, but not necessarily a marriage. But this has crossed the line. What are some of the indicators where, you know, your organization would come into play?
So there are many red flags, that's the term that we like to use, that a relationship might turn abusive. I want to go back to what you said. The Women's Center provides lots of educational programs in the schools, and we have a program specifically around healthy relationships and dating violence. Okay. So understanding what are elements of a healthy relationship and what these red flags are. So we're already having these conversations with our youth. So some red flags could be isolation from family and friends, an abuser telling you, don't hang with them, more important, trying to isolate you and get rid of your support system. Possessiveness, having to check your phone, who are you texting, who are you calling, let me look at your Facebook account, let's look at Twitter, and being very possessive and not having your own privacy. Telling women what they can wear, who they can go out with, jealousy that is abnormal, and there are lots of different red flags that can be indicators that something's wrong, and if you know early on that this might turn abusive, it's much more easier to get out.
And then at some point, if it gets, well, it's interesting because we talked briefly, you said it's not just physical abuse, like what we saw in that videotape in the elevator, but emotional, sexual, verbal, and even economic abuse. Break some of those down for us. What does that look like?
So economic abuse is when an abuser is controlling the finances in a relationship. This makes it hard for the victim to leave because they have no way to support themselves. Emotional abuse has long-lasting effects and is harder to identify. So this involves manipulation, making the victim feel like they are responsible for what is going on, telling the victim that no one else would love them, they would be nothing without the abuser, and really playing mind games and making it hard for the victim to think that they can ever leave the relationship. So emotional abuse is really hard to see, but has really long-lasting effects on the victim and makes it really hard for them to leave.
Legislatively, what I mean, you know, it's interesting because I try to shy away from always looking to government to solve these problems. I mean, I think, you know, I come from the Christian perspective. I go to Walnut Hill Community Church, and they have marriage encounter classes, premarital counseling, for example, divorce help with, you know, families that are in trouble. So I believe that the faith community has a role to play. That, you know, if you're married, like that support group that you're talking about, far from cutting people off from that support group, we would say, well, we want to encourage that type of thing. So I don't also want to look to the government to solve all our problems, but you're here, and, you know, it's your job. So what are you doing? You said you were involved with some legislation.
Well, I think you're on the right track. If a family is lucky enough to have a faith community to to reach out to, that's great, because there's a lot of services that are provided through that. But too many families do not have that. Mm. And the isolation is exactly right. When they're cut off from all means of support, that's really important. And when there's children involved, that makes it even more complicated. They'll stay in a relationship for much longer for the sake of the children, and essentially, so they're right at that point is where the services that are provided, where someone could reach out to. We have a 211 number in Connecticut that you can call if you are in a crisis situation.
Just dial 211.
211, make sure, because that's an informational line to if you're having a feelings that you want to kill yourself, for example, as that support system. If you feel that you're in this kind of relationship that puts you at risk. And in some cases, we're talking about real risk to life.
Oh, yeah.
And in that case,
for a police officer,
they need
the most dangerous call you can go on is a domestic.
That's exactly right.
Call.
That's right.
And it gets bad.
Exactly. So they need immediate help, which means being taken out of the environment they're in with their children. Mm-hmm. So they need a place to go to. They need a place to be able to sleep overnight and to be protected from a security standpoint. So legislatively, we have put more penalties and protection around that situation so that they can separate
themselves.
Restraining
orders,
exactly,
things like that.
Exactly, making that easier, because oftentimes that is a huge issue. Mm-hmm. And being able to provide services for those people that literally find themselves on the street and indigent. Mm. And you don't want them to risk the lives of themselves and their children as well.
Now, does the Women's Center in Danbury, will you interface with state and local governments? Is that where you get some referrals? Is there any communication between this?
Yes, we do work with legislators to talk about our issues, to make sure legislation is advocating for victims' rights and supporting victims, and we do have great relationships with senators.
So when you, like, at the Women's Center in Danbury, how do people get in touch? Will people be referred to you through the courts? Is it just people calling and saying, I have a friend, or I'm in need, please help? How can people get in touch with you? Where to turn for help? And how do people, I would imagine it's normally women, access your services?
Mm-hmm. Well, we do have court advocates that work in the court with the victims to make sure that their rights are advocated for.
Okay.
So we will get in touch with victims in that way. We do have a shelter that we provide housing for victims, and we do have a good relationship with the police to respond to victims when they are in need. There are many different ways that people can get in touch with our services. Mm-hmm. Again, we have our 24-hour hotline. People can call if they are victims themselves, or if they are secondary victims and they know someone who is going through this, to learn how to support a family or a loved one who might be a victim.
And Marty, it's not just government providing actual services, delivery services, or financial support to that. Mm-hmm. There's also a great deal of this has to do with the kind of laws on the books to help them through the legal process and to provide free legal service and support and representation when they literally do not have any access to any funds at all. Mm. That truly feeling completely on their own, which is one of the principal reasons that oftentimes they stay in an abusive relationship far longer than is healthy or safe.
Yeah, I would imagine, and maybe, I know you haven't been there that long, but would you say, generally speaking, that in a difficult economy, does that put more stress on family relations and therefore you have more domestic abuse, or not necessarily?
Not necessarily. It's important to know that domestic violence is not due to anger. It's about power and control. Huh. So just because there is stress in the household doesn't necessarily mean that the abuser is going to turn abusive. Mm-hmm. It's not about anger. It's about power and control. Mm-hmm. So it really just depends on the situation.
Hmm. And there's a bullying attitude about it, right? That bullying attitude is, and what is important to note as well, this completely crosses all economic lines.
Yeah.
It's not in poor communities. You'd be surprised.
Yeah.
In the communities that I represent, the incidence of domestic violence is really quite high.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not just, you know, some families that outwardly would seem like they don't have any financial concerns or pressures or something like that. Okay, so again, if people want to get in touch with you, the phone number is 203-731-5206, and it's the Women's Center in Danbury. I want to give you the final word. Is there anything else we haven't talked about or something that you want to make sure our vast viewing audience knows about?
Well, this video has certainly heightened awareness of our issue, but it shouldn't take a video like this for us to understand that domestic violence is brutal and horrific and that we need to stand up as a society and say this isn't right. So we need to continue working on this issue. It shouldn't take a video like this for us to feel outrage. We should already be upset at what's happening in our communities, in our neighborhoods, to people we love and know.
Great. Well, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
I really appreciate it. Stacey Aaron, thank you for all you're doing. I want you to stick around because we have a little roundtable discussion afterwards. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate it. Next up, we're going to have a roundtable discussion, then we're going to be talking a bit about the political issues of the day. We are chocked full of incredibly powerful legislators, but I would be remiss if I didn't point out that today is 9/11, and it's the anniversary of that horrific attack on America. I have a personal connection with 9/11 that's pretty sad. I have a painting company, and there was part of what we would do, this is going back to like the 80s and 90s, is we would go out and recruit college students at small Christian colleges, primarily in the Midwest. Well, we were in Orange City, Iowa, and we had set up our table, and we were recruiting students to come work and paint houses in suburban New York, New Jersey, Connecticut during the summer. And a friend of mine, this guy right here, Bo Costas, walked up as a tall, handsome, he was on a basketball scholarship. And the first time I met Bo would have been like 1988, 89 in Orange City, Iowa. And he was going to Northwestern College, not Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. That's another school. This is a small Dutch Reformed school in Northwest Iowa. Bo came up and said, oh, I would love to go to New York. I would love, what are you doing? You're painting houses? Great, I'll paint houses for you in New York. He just wanted to come. He was originally from the Czech Republic, we think. We're not sure. Czechoslovakia, Slovakia, Czech Republic, it gets a little confusing. But he was a great basketball player and just had a great spirit. And Bo came out and he worked for our painting company for 4 summers while he was going to college. And he just loved New York, he loved America, and he loved life. From there, he went on to become a maitre d' at Tavern on the Green. You'll recall that restaurant, I was out, now it's back, but it's an iconic restaurant just off of Central Park in downtown New York. He became a maitre d' there. I remember how proud I was to take my then pregnant wife down to Tavern on the Green, and there was Bo. I knew the maitre d'. It was an exciting time. So from there, he put himself through Baroque College in an MBA program. I mean, this is a guy who came over here, literally a great American story. And when you hear about all the immigration going on, I'm very pro-immigration in this sense. Not so much about guys coming over on jet skis across the Rio Grande, but Bo was just grasping all that America had to offer. He put himself through Baroque College, got an MBA. And I remember I would have Bo on my cell phone, and we sort of adopted him. That's him with my son. This is my son, who's now 25 years old and a lot older than he was in that picture. But he came out, and before Thanksgiving or Christmas or Easter, it seemed like a week or so before, I'd always get a call from Bo. I go, "Hey, Bo, how are you?" And hey, Marty, he had this deep voice. He was like a he modeled for a while too. He said, "Oh, Marty, how are you?" I said, "Hey, Bo." I go, "You know, Thanksgiving's next week. Do you have any plans?" And he's, "Well, no, Marty, I don't have any plans." And he would come out to the house, and he would always bring presents for the kids. I mean, but it was always over the top. I remember once he brought this. I mean, it wasn't a teddy bear. It was a teddy bear. I mean, this thing could stand on its own in the corner of a little girl's room, and that was for my daughter, Grace. My kids loved Bo. He was like an extension of the family. Later on, he met Suzanne. That's a picture of Suzanne. She was equally drop-dead gorgeous. She was from Sweden. I said, "Bo, if you got this immigration thing, you got to pick a pretty American girl. It'll help out with the whole immigration thing." But love knew no barriers, and Bo fell in love with Suzanne. And he was going to ask Suzanne to marry him, and he bounced it off my wife. He said, "Well, I'm going to Europe next week, and so I thought I'd write her a letter." And he began to read this letter. "Dear Suzanne, I will be in Europe next week, and I would like to consider spending the rest of my life with you. If you're open to this proposal, please be prepared to discuss it upon my return from Europe." And Bo, you know, guys are not always so smart in these emotional things. He ran it past my wife, and I think my wife took the letter and ripped it up and said, "What are you, crazy? You can't, this isn't a contract. You gotta take Suzanne in your arms and hug her and say, 'I love you and I can't live without you, please marry me.'" Which he did, and she became his fiance. My wife and I would go down to Manhattan, and we did this for a couple of years in a row. I remember, we would pick the play, they would pick the restaurant. So we would get the tickets to the play, and then they would take us out to the restaurant. And then the next year, we would reverse it. And I remember walking down the street with Bo and Suzanne. They were like 10 paces in front of us. And all the businessmen walking past would look at Suzanne, and they were just smitten by how gorgeous she was. And Bo was like an extension of my family. My kids loved Bo. 13 years ago, after Bo had gotten his MBA at Baruch College, put himself through school, he was working, making a lot of money for a company called Cantor Fitzgerald. Cantor Fitzgerald was on the 98th floor of Tower 1 at the World Trade Center. Bo was living with Suzanne. He got up early because he would make calls over to Europe in the morning. He was very hardworking. He was down at the World Trade Center when the first plane hit 13 years ago. He called home. He called to Suzanne. Suzanne was in the shower, so he left a voicemail. Suzanne got a knock on her door. Her friend said, "Turn on the TV, turn on the TV. Something terrible's happened." She saw what happened, and she knew that that was the building that her fiancé, my friend Bo Costas, was in. Like so many that day, she threw on a sweatshirt and went down there, frantically spent the whole day going from hospital to hospital. No Bo, no Bo. She came back after that long day, and there on the message machine, there was a call, a message waiting, light blinking. The message from Bo was, "Something just hit the building. I'm getting the hell out of here." And that's the last we heard of Bo. Suzanne held on for a few more days. You saw those, if you were around on September 11, 13 years ago, you saw those pictures, beautiful people in the prime of their life, in the spring of their life, like my friend Bo. "Have you seen my dad? Have you seen my mom? Have you seen my son?" And they were gone, taken from us. Every 9/11, I think of my friend Bo. I think of what life would have been like if we would have had more Broadway plays and dinners out. I think of the beautiful children that Bo and Suzanne would have had. I think of my children who it left an indelible mark in their lives. It may sound crazy, but both my kids have had little memorial, very small, especially my daughter, little memorial tattoos of Bo. It affected them. And I guess when I think about 9/11 and I look back at it, I think, what a terrible waste. What a shame it is that there are people in this world that somehow think that destroying a young life like Bo is going to make some statement or some issue or going to further some cause. But it isn't just the wanton slaughter of human lives. You don't just kill people. You kill their future. You kill everything that has to be done. Haven't we had enough of this killing? And now I'm a little exhausted. You know, State Senator Toni Boucher is here today, and she's done a number of these memorial services today. It's her job. And before here, she just sent out a text saying how it's just wearing. And now we have this next group that's coming along, and they've decided that Allah wants them to kill people. And now we got to go fight these people. 9/11 is a tough time. It's a tough time to look back at. It's a tough time to remember. It's a tough time to think about what could have been if it wasn't for this wanton slaughter. And I guess at times like this, you just have to look heavenward and say, God, please help us. Please help us. And let this scourge of militant, whacked out Islamic terrorism come to a close. It just can't go on. So there's just some thoughts. I don't know how we switch gears from that, but I want to thank State Representative Dan Carter for coming in. I want to thank so much Senator Toni Boucher for coming back in, and our resident intellectual professor at large, Jim Bellano. Thank you very much for coming in. I just wanted to share that. Every 9/11, I remember we went to the U.S. Open tennis tournament, and it's always like right before 9/11. That was the last time I spent with Bo. And it's very sad. It's
very sad. I share your sadness today. It was very difficult to get through the day.
Yeah.
Everything came back. Every emotion. You know, 5 young men from my church perished. They left 11 children fatherless, and nothing was left, not even the dust on the buildings. And thank goodness Connecticut has a memorial for them with a stone. At Sherwood Island Park. So if people do go by there in Westport, on exit 18 at Sherwood Island Park, there's a beautiful, beautiful memorial, and each has a granite stone with their names etched in it and some lovely benches so families can actually go there and be able to pay their respects, look out in Long Island Sound, and know that Connecticut never forgets.
Wow, wow. I know in Ridgefield they actually have a piece of the World Trade Center, a charred piece of I-beam. And it's there, and it's a place for people to remember. You don't want to. It's just a shame.
It's so tragic, but we don't want it to be repeated. Yeah. We have to stay vigilant, and we can't forget.
Yeah.
And right now, too, extending our solidarity with our friends that are in Israel and our Jewish friends among us as well, because they struggle all the time, and we need to constantly remind people about what has happened in the past and how it can happen again if we aren't really vigilant and being involved.
Yeah, you got to understand. I mean, it's so foreign to us, because as Americans, you grow up in the leafy suburbs, you just want to chew bubble gum and go play, you know, baseball and hang out with your kids and. Boy, you know, this summer we're going to go to Disney World together, and ain't life grand? You know, what the heck are all these people, what are they so upset about? Where is this hatred, this obsession coming in, and how could it just take over an entire religion and decide that this is it's going to be a really great thing? Allah told us to, you know, kill a bunch of people.
Well, you're right. Everybody got this information from a history book. So they were removed until September 11th, when it was brought on our doorstep and made to be real. Because people, some, do not believe that there could be that kind of real evil in the world.
Yeah.
They just don't. And there has to be a realization that there is, and that we have to be strong in the face of it, because if we're weak, it continues.
Yeah.
It's like the bully discussion we just had a minute ago.
Mm-hmm.
You're allowing not an individual, but an entire group or nation to become bullies to others, to the point where, you know, there's real massacres that occur.
Yesterday I was at the Capitol and I was commenting on the new security features in the Capitol. Right. They've upgraded security a lot. And I was speaking to someone who was about to leave, and I made a couple of comments about how I really didn't like the security because I feel like it separates us from the people and that sort of thing. And she made a comment, she didn't really care too much about it, wasn't that big of a deal, but she grew up in a terrorist country in the sense that she was living in Ireland and grew up with car bombings and grew up with all that sort of stuff and, you know, knowing if you're going to be on a bus that there's no risk. And I can't imagine what that would be like here to that extent, but it's kind of happening. It's, you know, my girlfriend commutes to Manhattan every day, and she's talked about you know, what's been going on in Manhattan and preparing for 9/11, and we actually had the discussion last night of whether or not she should take the train.
Right.
So that's a much different way of looking things at, like, you know, the way we all grew up. And it is sad, and it's terrible. And then, you know, eventually we're going to have to do something about it because it's not going to stop. It's not going to stop.
What it is, it's a new normal. I have to tell you, right after 9/11, I did put in legislation to put those security system into the Capitol because you're really basically there as sitting ducks, is the way the building is so old. And the argument that was used then was, well, we want to be open to the people and so forth. So it didn't pass. And they put it on the shelf until just recently. Now, you know, I didn't have to say a word. There was a recognition that there is a new normal that we have to face. We are so global now, where everything can touch each other, whether it's an Ebola virus that is existing in another part of the hemisphere that so quickly can enter our country because we're such a mobile, not just America, but, but a very mobile and global world.
Not just interconnected, you know, you can have these, you know, vague, primitive, you know, cultures that are beheading people somewhere in the Middle East. Now, you have it in living color on your phone.
Right. That's exactly
immediately.
Right. That's right. It's like going back to the Bible, isn't it?
Yeah.
When they started to put, you know, signs on door frames that identified someone's firstborn male child.
Yeah.
And here we are today.
Well, they're putting an N on different, I think it's Mosul in Iraq, this ISIS group is going in, and if you have an N, I think it stands for Nazarene, it basically says there are Christians in this house, and you're either going to kill them or they have to leave.
So, but not only do you have to battle the threat, you also have to battle the naysayers, because look at Israel. It seems like an obvious situation. Three teenagers are killed, the rockets start coming, and they defend themselves. They defend themselves in a way that, you know, most people think it was pretty civilized. You know, they're telling them, we're going to bomb this building, get out. And one of the and Hamas says, go in there.
No, they drop a dud on the building first.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay, here's one without the, you know, gunpowder.
But even here, you're saying, you look at the articles in the last couple of days, ISIS is an overblown threat. You see that.
Absolutely.
People say, let's not get crazy here in the U.S. ISIS is not a threat. And you know, what do you say to that? So you're battling both sides
of it. Know, part of that is, there is a whole group that say the entire Holocaust was a hoax.
Oh. Yeah.
We even had that with Sandy Hook. So
there
are people that literally, this is the truth.
This
is truth. And as a result, you know, I have a friend who was a Quaker, and his father actually led the peace movement during the Second World War in New York. And it's interesting to me because he's a Quaker, and yet he is not against guns and not against retaliation because his father told him when he was younger that once they found out, because he was leading the peace movement, not to get into the Second World War, not to go to Europe. When he found out what had happened in Auschwitz and Dachau to these innocent millions, we're talking about 6 million people that were systematically targeted and secretly. That's why we need freedom of the press.
Absolutely.
Because the press has to have access to this. And when he found out what happened, he was so regretful that he actually told his son he would have taken a gun himself and gone over there if he knew what had transpired, because he could not believe that people could be that cruel.
Well, we just had a show a week or two ago, it's all blending together now, about the Christian martyrs and what's going on with the Christian martyrs. And you think of, like, Germany in the 1930s, where it was all done in secret, and you know, this genocidal platform that the Nazis had was all kept under wraps and everything was fine, and you know, they had the Olympics and everything. But then all of a sudden, retroactively, you find out with ISIS, They're gleefully videotaping. Yeah, we're going to go in. We're going to slaughter every soldier. We're going to slaughter the Christians. We're going to behead them. Watch this. You know, so there's really no excuse. Caller, do you have something to add? And by the way, the phone number here is 203-438-2003. If you'd like to add something, we certainly have quite a brain trust here with a state rep and a senator and a galdang professor. Plus, there's me. I just have a lot of good ideas. But caller, do you have something to add?
Yes, I would just like to have the people on the panel comment from the previous ones. We seem to have somehow got been able to get to a point where we accept bad behavior, try to explain it away, and have no consequences for it. I think that is emerged in, I think it's more noticeable now in terms of domestic violence. But when it's brought to people's attention that bad behavior exists in their community, I'm experiencing it, that I finally won my 3-year battle with what I considered despicable bad behavior by a group of people in Richfield. I won. Medicare is coming down on them. Other powers to be are coming down on them. And I am getting sullen silence. And when you reach out for help, the people that we're going to have to vote for don't want to know. I would just like their comments on why legislatures don't want to know that bad behavior seems to be the acceptable norm.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for that.
It's not being done just by religious fanatics. It is being done by people who are in positions of authority and are using it not to our good. Take care.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think she's probably referring to, we were talking earlier about domestic violence, and in that case, as I'm sure Anne would agree, it's a family issue. Let's not get involved. But what about that? What about, bad behavior that's just not addressed?
I don't look at it as a family issue, not getting involved. It's a crime. It's a crime. And I think what happens oftentimes, we see people who maybe don't come forward, or we hear rumblings about it, and I think it's a society. We know it exists, but it's not always right out in front of us.
Right.
And I think it's the problem, because it happens in home, it happens in the family. But I've had constituents contact me for help, and I've sent them to...
In domestic violence situations?
In domestic violence situations. Mm-hmm. And I've sent them to the Women's Center here in Danbury, because I'm telling you, it is probably the best resource that we have in this area.
Uh-huh.
Right. And regionally. It's good. In fact, they have hotlines you can call at nighttime. And they may not be in Danbury, but they'll call the person on call in Danbury, and they'll get somebody some help right away.
Wow.
And I've had constituents call me, because we are public figures.
That's right.
So I don't think it's we turn a blind eye to it. I think we do everything we can to do something about it and be proactive. You may have talked earlier about legislation, even sexual violence on campus at UConn.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah. Like,
we're trying to do some things that really make a difference, because it's not just a family situation, it's a crime.
That's right. Mm-hmm. In fact, we convened a very important informational meeting, and then we followed up with that with actual public hearings, where victims, the courageous ones, have come forward, explained their situation. We analyzed what each of our colleges were doing about it, found some real gaps, and created some model legislation now for the rest of the country on college campuses, and leading the way through bad experiences that had happened here. Mm. But it provided an opportunity for change and for closing those gaps and looking at what the very best practices are, so we create a safe environment on a college campus. Many kids leave home for the very first time. They're away from family support system. They're away from the people that they know, and they will could find themselves in a risky situation.
Yeah.
And I think it behooves all colleges to have a good process in place and the right kind of training, too, even for their first responders and on-campus police. There's a tremendous amount of desire to cover up any bad things that happen to college, because they want to keep their reputation,
yeah.
And they don't want people to be frightened or scared away. Right. The bottom line is that all colleges have that problem.
Yeah.
It's not just UConn or state system here. It happens in all and in Ivy Leagues as well.
Mm-hmm. A lot of it's alcohol related too.
Sure.
I think,
exactly.
And they're not cracking down on that.
That's right.
But the other good point that was made is that this is a crime. You know, the feeding frenzy out in the press now is about Ray Rice, and they're really laying everything at the feet of the NFL.
Yeah.
Now the NFL, you know, the two-game suspension is absurd on any level.
Right.
Whether they saw the video or not, I don't know why the video makes it worse. You know, he hit a woman. Oh, is it on video? Oh, that's six more games.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, is the spotlight going to be turned on these prosecutors in New Jersey because they didn't prosecute him?
That's right.
They didn't bring him to trial.
That's right.
You know, they had both videos from the beginning.
Yeah.
And they decided, listening to his wife, well, maybe she might not be a witness for us, she may turn, and they put him into this program, and the judge signed off on it. So the spotlight needs to go there, because they're the authorities.
But,
the
but
NFL is, you know.
Well, but there's a celebrity status to this. Remember the O.J. Simpson trial,
sure.
For
yeah.
sure. There's a certain status and exposure, and again, whether it's a high-profile university or it's the NFL, you know, there's that whole concern about, you know, protecting the image.
Uh-huh.
Rather
right.
than the right thing to do, the proper thing to do is to consider the victim first and number one and be transparent and open about it, because at the end of the day, that will really do more
right.
to increase and protect the reputation of whether
of
it's
course.
A college or it's an NFL.
Yeah, how's their image doing?
Exactly. Yes, exactly.
With
that.
This,
now,
right. yeah.
you're exactly right.
Yeah.
I was minding my own business, you know, running a business, working, and I go to my mailbox, you know, bill, catalog. My wife gets tons of catalogs. And then I get this little piece of direct mail, bold leadership to revitalize our struggling state. I don't know if you two know, but this year is an election year. I don't know if you know that.
Really?
Now, help me understand. They just had a Quinnipiac poll come out. On the governor's race, and what were the percentage on that?
6 to 8%.
So Tom Foley is ahead of Governor Malloy by 6 to 8%.
Right.
This far into the election
right.
cycle,
we're getting close.
What does that tell you? What are you're knocking on doors? Excuse me. You're talking to people. What are people's issues? What are they concerned about? What's going to happen in the state of Connecticut going forward?
I haven't met many people who Malloy hasn't made angry.
Really?
About something. Whether it's the pharmacists, for some of the legislation that he pushed through that devastated them and made it harder for them to do business in the state, to the regular businesses looking at the fees and things like that.
Right.
He's not been very popular. You know, it's still early to say because he's a great politician. I see his ads coming up, and he's taking all kinds of credits for, you know, more jobs and this and that. And most of it's smoke and mirrors as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll see what happens. And the other thing we can't discount is this whole Visconti factor.
Sure.
The Visconti factor.
Break that down for the vast viewing audience.
Basically, the way I understand is this Visconti's pulling a little bit from both sides right now. You know, a lot of us would have thought that maybe he would have pulled more from the conservative sides. But he's pulling from Malloy about 3%. He's pulling from Foley about 3%,
okay.
which is very interesting because he's just kind of doing
so
his own thing.
So he is running as a...
He's running, I guess, on his own.
Pro Second Amendment on the yes, on the unaffiliated line.
Unaffiliated,
so he is running on himself.
And he was here for
the
debate, right?
Yeah,
right. He got enough signatures to just get on the ballot,
okay.
And some perceive that as being a spoiler. Quite honestly, right now, as Representative Carter just said, rightly so. Right now, this is a governor that is very unpopular, and he's alienated a number of different groups that would typically be supportive of him. For example, the teachers and the teachers' unions. They're not buying all this backtracking, and that's what we're seeing right now.
Right.
All sorts of things are being backtracked. No longer is there school reform. No longer does he want to support testing and evaluations in schools. No longer is he going to allow giving something that he championed and pushed, which is giving individuals not in this country legally a valid driver's license.
Uh-huh.
So he's holding that back until after the election. But more than that, it's just not actually just the issues and the fact that the economy is struggling and has not gotten back on track, and in fact people feel like they're being taxed to death and taxed out of the state, being forced out. It's also that his style of management, his personality has been very negative, mm-hmm. and just not a friendly guy that people, like Jody Rell, was the most popular governor in the history of the state. In fact, had the highest polling numbers in the entire United States for the yeah. longest period of time.
Yeah.
You know, she was the integrity governor. But, you
Come
know,
in,
she had her struggles.
Messes.
She had her struggles, though, and mm-hmm. that was difficult. But the public forgave her for whatever it was because they liked her so much. They trusted her. Mm-hmm. That level of trust, that likability, is just not there right now. So, you know, I think that they're overlooking the opposition's missteps because right now it's almost, as long as they're not Governor Malloy at the mm-hmm. moment, they're willing to give someone else a chance to turn the state around, which it desperately needs.
So, okay, you've been through a lot of these election cycles here, specifically right. in Connecticut. And every time I convince myself, this is going to change, you know, DiBasella is going to beat Himes, Foley's going to get in the governor's mansion, this is going to be great. Obviously, people see we're in trouble here, we need change, we need a fresh start, it couldn't be more clear. And then the day after the election, Al Robinson calls in and goes,
Well, 2010, especially, you had the big national wave
yeah.
of Republicans sweeping the House and state legislatures, and it just didn't happen here. But, you know, the governors, and so the congressional seats, whether there's hope there, you know, it's kind of up in the air. There's no Senate, federal Senate.
DiBasella Hines, does DiBasella have a chance?
It's hard to say. You know, people hate Congress, but they love their yeah. members of Congress. And you see they're giving out a lot of goodies as we get close to Election Day. But, you know, the governor's race, and for to a lesser extent the state reps, mm-hmm. a little more personal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think the governor, because Connecticut has gone back between Republican governors and Democratic governors, it's a different animal mm-hmm. than at the federal level. So, you know, if Foley's polling well now, that's a good sign. My guess is it'll tighten up. Probably those people, especially teachers, I think, when push comes to shove, probably will go for Malloy.
Not at all.
Or they'll stay home. I don't think they'll go for
exactly.
Foley.
I think a lot.
So turnout is going to be the key.
Turnout will be key. Yeah. I would predict that we are going to see some changes that no one expects, and I think they're going to be Republican wins that no one expects, because I get that, because I'm, like Dan, mm-hmm. out there every day with the voters. And what we're sensing is that they would probably rather just stay home. They're not excited
yeah.
on the Democratic side.
Yeah,
they're very motivated on the Republican side, because they really want to see a change. I have talked to arts community that is typically supportive of a Democratic leadership. They're very disenchanted by it.
Right.
They
uh-huh.
feel that whole area has been, you know, basically ignored, if not even trampled on. And teachers tell me that, you know, they don't buy any of this backtracking. They were insulted from day one
uh-huh.
when he basically said in a State of the State address that teachers basically all they have to do is stand up there
yeah.
and take up space, and they automatically
They have that on tape, right?
Oh, they do. Yeah. They do. And it's not something that he can just apologize for
sure.
now. Because
yeah.
it certainly yeah. looks like it's just being done.
I know from experience, you really don't want to tick off teachers, generally speaking.
Well, teachers are important in
absolutely.
Our society.
Yeah. Absolutely.
They are.
I love
sure.
You talk about a lack of enthusiasm. Did you hear about President Clinton was in the state?
Yes.
And it couldn't even fill up. I think they were giving away snacks, too. And still, there wasn't. The room was half filled, and yeah. there was no energy. And he was here on behalf of Malloy. What are you seeing?
I've seen the same thing. I mean, obviously, people are very angry with the way the Malloy administration has mm-hmm. run so many things in this state. They understand that they, in the beginning, they had the largest tax increase in history. It's hurting businesses. It's hurting middle-class families. There's mm-hmm. no question about it. And the fact is, I think people are starting to get wise that we've robbed every account we possibly can to spend it in their way. And now next year, we're looking at $1 billion deficit both those years in a row. There's no way to get that money unless we cut spending or raise taxes. Now, he's claiming, oh, he's not going to touch taxes, not going to have a tax hike. Listen, do the math and look at his history.
Yeah.
You know darn well what they're setting us
mm-hmm.
up for.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to read the writing between the wall. I mean, when is enough that we're going to stop giving these guys the power to do this to us over and over and over again? So I am worried about this Visconti factor. I do think he's going to be a spoiler. Okay. I am just very nervous about that.
Well, the Pelto factor would have helped that, but that...
Yes. Would have. Yeah. But if you, like you say, he's taking votes from both sides, that could even it.
Now. So is Visconti's thing, is it the gun legislation? Is that his big platform?
Yes.
Okay, could just give me on camera one right here, 1 second. Okay. Let's talk man to man here. All you Second Amendment guys, I'm one of you, okay? I got a closet full of camo. I got a deer head on my wall. I got a 12-gauge and a deer rifle in my basement, okay? I'm one of you, okay? I like Visconti. I like him a lot. He's not going to be the next governor. I like him. Believe Visconti, if you watch that, I like you. I got nothing but love for you. Let's wear camo and go hang out in a tree together. But for the love of God... You Second Amendment folks, which I love, NRA, all the way, don't vote not for Foley and vote for Visconti. You might blow this whole thing. And I know Tom Foley. He has a respect for the Second Amendment. I have two legislators right here. They both have a respect for the Second Amendment. You want to turn this all over to all the liberal Democrats who want to literally come into your house and take away your guns. You think I'm joking? It's true. You got a magazine that has 10 bullets, not 8. They want to come in and confiscate your guns. It bothers me. We were given this right from our founding fathers, and it's a good check against runaway power authority coming down from Washington. I get the whole thing. Don't vote for Visconti if you're going to vote for Foley. If you're going to vote for Malloy anyways, I think a vote for Visconti is a good idea. But if you're going to vote for Foley, go in there, hold your nose, and vote for Foley. Don't throw it away on Visconti. Are we clear here? These guys can't say this. I can. You know why? Because I don't get paid for this. Okay? Work with me on this, guys. Trust me. But you Second Amendment guys that, you know, are going to, you know, vote for Malloy, don't do that. I mean, it's just a complete disaster. Thank you. That's just an editorial comment.
Well, there you go.
But I'm serious about this, and we've gone around and around, and I got nothing but love for the Second Amendment, but for gosh sakes, don't be stupid about it.
Well, you know, I'm concerned you're holding back.
tell
us what you really
mean.
That's right. No, but I think there are a lot of people who really like Visconti. I mean, he's a great guy.
I like the guy. Have you seen his videos? He's a man's man.
I think what happens is, as conservatives get so principled in what they do that sometimes they're going to vote for the principle and they're going to forget common sense.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a problem. That's what's going to stick
us. That's right.
This time around, if we're not careful, because I don't want to see another term up there working with Malloy. And you know what's interesting? And I'll say this, I mean, I don't really have anything against him personally. You meet him and talk to him.
Yeah.
He's not a bad guy.
Yeah.
But I see how he is a bulldozer, and he doesn't take things into account like what the legislature wants as far as some of us. And he goes and does what he wants to do, and it's damn the torpedoes. I'm not going to work with that again. I don't want to work with that in Hartford. And I hope we get somebody with better sense.
Right.
We got a chance here, guys. Yeah. It's not always about hiring the next guy. It's about firing the other guy. Got it? Got it? Are we clear on this? Lightning round. What are your final thoughts?
Well, I think a lot of it falls on Foley. You know, you talked about Clinton appearing. Clinton had remarks, went over the airwaves. I haven't heard a reaction to it, talking about the governor's surplus. He says, you had a surplus. I mean, let's get on that. He doesn't have to make up stuff himself. He can go to statistics. Connecticut is in the bottom three in business development, highest per capita debt. These are statistics he can get from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. So it's on Foley to win the race.
Right. Absolutely.
Toni, last thoughts. We're wrapping it up. This is frightening. I don't know. Let's see. Can you wrap it up?
I can.
Okay.
I can. You only need one poll, and that poll is the Gallup poll that says that 50%, one of out of every two of us in Connecticut, would leave the state if they could. It's not because they want to. It's because these policies that have been put in place that are negative policies by a governor that shuts the door on all good ideas and refuses to work in a bipartisan way.
Yeah.
That has forcing people to leave. That is hurting business. It's hurting everything. It's hurting our schools.
Uh-huh.
There are fewer enrollments in our college campuses, you know, and there's less taxes that bring the revenue to support government.
Final thought.
Okay, so I'll give my final thought. My message is to your audience. Don't change your address, change your vote. Don't leave Connecticut, stay here and vote the right way.
Absolutely. By gosh, we're gonna stay here, we're gonna go down fighting here. I wanna thank my guests, especially Ann Rodwell-Lawton from the Women's Center in Danbury, Connecticut. Thank you all for coming in, and we'll see you next week on the Marty Heiser Show. I have no idea what we're gonna talk about, but let's see what happens. Good night.